Thank you very much. What a great song, a great truth. What is in your focus? What's your vision? Is it a career? Is it money? Is it a house? Is it a car? Is it possessions? Is it a position? Or could it be that it is God? Our goal is not growth. Our goal should be God. Our goal should not be possessions. They should be the potentate. They should be Him. Be thou my vision. What a great truth that is. 1 Samuel chapter 30 is where we find our passage of Scripture today. And thank you, church family, for being faithful, especially on a holiday weekend. It's a joy to see sweet friends here. Thank you for making a priority to be in God's house this morning. And, of course, while we're here today, there are people across the street, probably about 1,600 Spanish-speaking people across the way here. And then in different properties around our building, there are children's churches, teen churches going on simultaneously. But thank you for being in this auditorium this morning. Great music, great participation. Always remember it is your presence and your participation that brings blessing to the work of God. Be there. Be where you're supposed to be and do what you're supposed to do. These are things that can bless and help the work of God. Our Bible is 66 books in one book compiled together. 39 are in the Old Testament, written before Jesus came. 27 are in the New Testament, written after Jesus went back to heaven. The first five books are the books of the Pentateuch, or the books of the law. We believe that Moses was God's instrument to use to write what he wanted to say in Genesis through the book of Deuteronomy. Then beginning next is the book of Joshua, and all the way through to Ezra, we find that these are books of history of the nation of Israel. Primarily cover what happens to them as they go into the promised land in Joshua and they claim their possession all the way through to Babylonian captivity. It covers their history. And then we have the books of poetry, which begin with the book of Job and end out with the book of Song of Solomon after Psalms and Proverbs and Ecclesiastes. And then the greater books, or larger books, we call the major prophets, Isaiah and Jeremiah and Ezekiel and Daniel. And then we also have the minor prophets, not less significant, but less in volume than the greater prophets or the major prophets there before going to the New Testament. The book of 1 Samuel is a historical book that tells the nation of Israel and about their first king. And then in 2 Samuel, you see the second king, David, come into a focus as the actual king. The children of Israel, after being a theocracy, meaning God was in charge and he oversaw their work, they started looking around and they saw other countries have kings. And people would ask them, who's your king? And they said, we don't really have one. What? Well, we don't have a king. What? You're weird. What's wrong with you? Who's your king? You know, well, God, we're run by God. And that got to them. And then they had a man who led them. And Samuel led them, and he was kind of the prophet and the priest in the house of God. And he did not train his children well. And so his boys were derelict, and he did not give the attention to train the next generation. And the people of God used that as an excuse against him to say, we need a king. And they asked for a king, and God said, okay, I'll give you a king. They gave him Saul, and Saul came onto the kingdom. He was a very humble guy at first, chasing donkeys for his father whenever he was approached by the prophet and anointed to be king. He did his service for 40 years. He was the king of Israel. The first part did pretty good, but then pride began to hide and resurface, and Saul was guilty of presumption. He was stubborn. He would do things his own way. He would pretend to listen to God, but then he would do what he wanted to do anyway, just like we do sometimes. He would rationalize why that what he was told to do was not a good idea, even though God told him to do it, and he would go another way and push hard his will. Many of us have had stop signs and stops in our life and barriers that God has put there to say, don't do that. Don't continue that relationship. Don't buy that item. Don't take that situation. And we rationalize, and Saul was that kind of a guy. That's why it was said of him by the prophet, rebellion is as a sin of witchcraft and stubbornness like idolatry. Saul was very self-willed, and he wasn't yielded to the Lord, and he would halfway obey, and he would always had an angle, how it would help him and how he could do things that would benefit him rather than just being somewhat of a reckless abandonment to the will of God. I've been that way before and so have you. But God says, you know what, I've rejected you, Saul. I'm going to get someone to replace you. Saul was angry and frustrated by that. He said, I've done something wrong, but honor me now. That's not that big of a deal. Don't take away the kingdom. And yet God did take away the kingdom and anointed a little young man, probably about 16 years old, out on the backside of the Judean hills watching sheep, called him in from his dad's house, anointed him. He was anointed several times to be king. That was the first of about three times that he was anointed king. And his name was David. David was someone that initially the Lord said, and I think you can be played out in his entire life, even though he grievously sinned against God. He was a man after God's own heart. But from the time he was anointed to be the king on the shepherd, after coming home in the backyard of his dad's place and then going back and watching sheep and then playing the guitar or the harp for the king and then doing some fighting and being quite successful, killed Goliath and put the Philistines to flight and all kinds of things, Saul's anger and his demonic impulses begin to hate David. And he hunted him like a dog for many years. You can read all of this in the book of 1 Samuel. He hunted him. He was all over the place. He opposed himself. He couldn't get his head together. And by the way, rebellion will do that to you. Stubbornness will do that to you. You won't be able to think straight. You'll have mood swings that will be unbelievable. Sometimes you'll be very amiable. The next day you'll be as irritable as you can be. You'll say, this is a good idea, and 2 days later, it's not a good idea. And you're going to find yourself very conflicted from within if you do not, if I do not submit to the Lord. Saul did not, and Saul, rebellion is like the sin of witchcraft. It's kind of like living in a crime-infested neighborhood with no doors on your house. You don't rest well. You're nervous. You've got all kinds of issues there. What submission does to God's will and our authorities, it puts the doors back on and closes them and puts a deadbolt on them. So you can have rest within your house, your mental house, if you will. Satanic influence come and they pester and aggravate and molest and cause all kinds of problems to a rebel. Someone who's a rebel thinks they're winning, but they're actually losing. They think they're in charge, but actually they're not. Our arms are way too short to box with a holy God. We need to submit to Him and don't argue with Him and yield to Him. He loves us. His commandments are not grievous. They're for us, not against us. But Saul had talked himself into thinking that God was against him and he didn't have to listen to Him and he had his own way of doing things and certainly complicated his life. During this time, God was preparing David for the kingdom. He's also preparing the kingdom for David. And David went through some real head-scratching times. It was frustrating. It was puzzling. He found himself gathering people and hiding from Saul. He had a friend in Saul's son, Jonathan, who helped him along and became a real fast friend to him. But he finally went into hiding, and he found that people wanted a leader and they had chosen to be the leader, but the guys who came to him were people who were in debt and disgruntled and frustrated. And he had somewhat of a motley crew, not a rock band, but a motley crew. He had a kind of a rough group. Some of them were very talented fighters and warriors, and they had a heart, and they had David's heart, and David had their heart. It got so bad that David realized that, you know, he was being hunted by the Israelites, that he teamed up with the Philistines to help them, to take care of his 600 men that fought with him and to take care of their families and their persons. He began to fight for the Philistines, not against God's people, but against others. And now they were thinking about going against God's people, and the lords of the Philistines came to Achish, the king of Philistines, and said, listen, I know David's done a lot of great things, and it looks like everything he touches turns to gold, and his guys are talented, but we don't trust him. And we're not going to go to the next battle with that guy. You've got to deal with him. And in chapter 29 of 1 Samuel, Achish came and approached David and said, David, we don't want you here in this battle. He said, I like you. He said, I have nothing. I trust you. He said, it's unbelievable what you do and how talented and gifted you are. He said, but the lords of Philistines have really put up a problem for me, and it's not good for you to fight with us. And David says, what have I done? I can't even, the children of Israel and Saul doesn't love me, and now you don't even trust me. But he probably brushed his hands off, said, all right, I'm going home. I'm going to go back and see my kids, see my wives. He had two wives at the time. By the way, that's not a condoned thing, but it always complicated life when you had multiple wives. It's not something God condoned. But he had two girls that were his wives. He had multiple children. The soldier boys with him, they had children, and they had remained in Ziklag. Ziklag was geographically several miles away from that point, and they told him to stay there. You take care of the family. We'll be back in a little bit. And they would usually come back with spoil and blessings from the battles and things that they had gotten. And they looked forward to coming home and seeing the wife and children. They looked forward to pulling back the tent flaps and all the little kids coming running out and seeing Daddy coming with David, the great warrior, and the 600 men with him. And each of the men were looking forward to getting a little bit of R&R and coming back home and seeing the kids and seeing the wives. And even those who were maybe single, they would be able to get some R&R and rest. I could just imagine here, they came over the hill, and instead of seeing little children run out to them, they saw Ziklag, that city, completely burned with fire. It was nothing but a pot of ashes. Every tent was burned. They had no idea what had taken place, but all they knew, there was no bodies. There were no dead bodies. That surprised them. But everything that they owned and everything that was there was nothing. And they come over that hill on their way home and excited, maybe dejected by the fact that Achish didn't even want them, their enemies didn't even want them to work with them. But kind of happy to say, enough on that. Let's go home and see the kids. Let's go home and see the wife. Let's get back to get some rest. Man, it's tiring being this soldier stuff. And then they come over the hilltop, and there they see all their expectations in a pile of ashes. And all that was left is just the evidence of yesterday's fire. And their hearts are broken. Let's pick up our scripture if we can, please, in 1 Samuel chapter 30. Verse number 1, it came to pass that when David and his men were come to Ziklag on the third day, 3 days traveling, that the Amalekites invaded the south and Ziklag and smitten Ziklag and burned it with fire. And had taken the women captives and that were therein, and they slew not any, either great or small, but carried them away and went on their way. So David and his men came to the city, and behold, it was burned with fire, and his wives and their sons, their daughters, had been taken captive. Then David and the people that were with him lifted up their voice and wept until they had no more power to weep. And David's two wives were taken captive, Ahinoam, the Jezreelitess, and Abigail, the wife of Nabal the Carmelite. And David was distressed, for the people spake of stoning him, because the soul of all the people was grieved, and every man for his sons and for his daughters. But David encouraged himself, and the Lord is God. An amazing passage of scripture. I can't even imagine the scene. If you could see 601 men sitting around and kicking ashes and sitting outside the city and thinking, where's my wife and what's somebody doing to them? Where's my kids? Is someone taking advantage of my children? Are they crying themselves to sleep? All my possessions are gone. And the men are so grieved, they cried till they had no more power to weep. Have you ever done that? Have you ever had a long night, a difficult season of life where you cried and you cried and you had no more power to cry? I haven't done that a lot of times in my life, but I think I could relate to a few times. When I got by myself, and it wasn't a cry like a sniffle and a wipe of a cheek. It was and the howling and the screaming, the yelling of these men, no doubt, really resonated throughout the camp. And they cried, and David cried. Then someone said, we ought to kill David. Well, stone him. He's the one who took us away. He's the one who caused all the problems. He's the lightning rod that brought all this judgment on us. And one guy in his fit of anger and hurt and pain decided, let's go stone David. Let's kill him. And David heard that in his ears, and he knew this. And you need to know this too, friends. Hurting people tend to hurt people. People who are grieving in their heart, oftentimes, if they do not give those hurts to the Lord, if they don't cast their care on the Lord and know that He cares for them, they begin to find their aim. And unfortunately, many Christians have fallen prey to bitterness and blame. Bitterness and blame. It can't be our fault. It's got to be somebody else's. We get tired of looking ourselves in the mirror and just seeing us, that we got to find someone else. And these hurting men said, we can't take the blame ourselves. It's got to be David. We got to kill somebody. Let's blame it on him. And they thought of stoning him. And of course, David was just equally sad for his own wife and children. But now, the church family, if you will, the soldier boys are with him. Those that are hurting with him now are pushing the finger toward him and blaming him. And the Bible says that David encouraged himself in the Lord. What do you do when difficult times come your way? When you have those long nights and you are crying and you are lonely and you are desperate, and you don't have any answers, all you have is a lot more questions than you had yesterday. And you don't know how things are going to turn out, and then it doesn't seem like all the people you would text or call are actually not taking your calls. They're not responding to your text. Matter of fact, some of them get a little smart and send you something back that hurts your feelings. In moments of difficulties, what are we going to do when that happens? We have an example, and the Bible tells us in the book of Corinthians that the things in the Old Testament are given to us for our examples to show us what we should do when we go through difficult times. Whether you sit in your car or your truck, whether you sit in a bedroom or an apartment, or whether you're at work at your desk or wherever it is, or across the world and you get these moments, let me give you a couple things I think that David did very wisely during this time. Let's see what he did. If you would, please look at your Bibles and turn to verse number 7. Once again, the Bible says that David encouraged himself in the Lord his God. Verse number 7, and David said to Abiathar the priest, Ahimelech's son, I pray thee bring me hither the ephod. And Abiathar brought hither the ephod to David. That was a part of a priest's garment. It represented the presence of the Lord and the representative of God. And in verse number 8, he did something very wise. Look, if we said, and read it with me, would you please, everyone together? You've already read it once, let's read it again. And David inquired at the Lord, saying, the Bible says that David did the first wise thing in this difficult time. He prayed. He inquired of the Lord. Listen, friend, when the difficulties are pressing in, when the children are wayward, when the marriage is struggling, when difficult times, when the finances are low and the bills are many, whenever the loneliness sets in and maybe even the harshness of other people that come upon you and your own friend and your father's friend, seems like they're just not taking calls right now, what can you do? You can pray. Oh, how praying rests the weary. Prayer can change the night to day. So in gladness or in sorrow, don't forget to pray. Make prayer your first response to a difficult time. Pray. Go to a prayer meeting. Pray. Go to your prayer closet. Go to God in prayer. Oh, what griefs we often forfeit. Oh, what needless pain we bear, all because we do not carry everything to God in prayer. Oh, so many of us, we want the help, but we're not willing to pray the price. We'll call, we'll text, we'll email, we'll strategize and even manipulate things to try to get something to help relieve the pain, the difficulties, the shortfall, instead of going to God in prayer. And here in a difficult time of David's life, probably the witch that most of us could not even relate to. As he saw everything he had, all his riches have turned to ashes. He doesn't know where his kids are. He doesn't know where his wives are. He doesn't see any hope. No clue. And he's sitting with 600 men who are frustrated and hurt as bad and want to come at him. But he did something good. He said, let me get to God. Let me inquire the Lord, what do you want me to do? Not inquire the Lord and say, why are you doing this to me? But what do you want me to do at this difficult time of my life? He prayed. And that's what you can do. That's what I can do when difficult times come, when they're overwhelming and the stress is heavy and the outlook is bleak. Pray. Take your burdens to the Lord and leave them there. Bear your heavy load before Him there in prayer. He'll give your spirit freedom. He'll lift the load you bear. Take your burdens to the Lord and leave them there. Give them to the Lord. Number two, he didn't ask, Lord, should I kill myself? Lord, what should I do? He said, should I pursue? Do you want me to go on? Do you want me to stay here? Because sometimes God tells you, stand still and see the salvation of the Lord. Sometimes it is wait. Some God's favorite tools are delay. Just say, wait, John, wait. You don't have to do anything. Just wait on the Lord. He'll help you. He'll strengthen your heart. But his prayer was, Lord, do I pursue them? Do I go over them? Do I continue on? And the Lord said, yes, sir, you go on. You're going to recover everything. And I think number two, when you're discouraged, number one, pray. Number two, press on. Persevere. Walk on. Continue. When things go wrong, as they sometimes will, when the road you're trudging seems all uphill, when the funds are low and the debts are high, and you want to smile but you have to sigh, oh no. When care presses you down a bit, rest if you must, but don't quit. Success is failure turned inside out, the silver tint of the clouds of doubt, and you can never tell how close you are. It may be near. Success may be near when it seems like it's so far. So stick to the fight when your heart is hit. It's when things go wrong that you mustn't quit. And keep on going. Don't quit things that are right. I was teaching a Sunday school class this morning with a great group of people, and the Bible tells in 1 Thessalonians chapter 5, prove all things, hold fast to the things that are good. Evaluate, but hang on to things that are eternal in nature. Hang on to things that will transfer into the eternal column on your check stop. Put things there and hold fast to the things that are most beneficial. It's sad to me that many people get discouraged and they quit the good things. They stop going to church. They stop their Sunday school class. They quit driving the bus. And God says, pursue, continue. The old farmer, if you strike a thorn or a rose, keep going. If it hails or if it snows, keep it going. There's no sense to sit and whine when the fish ain't on your line. Just bait your hook and keep it trying. Keep it going. The weather kills your crop, keep going. Though it's work to reach the top, keep going. I suppose you're out of every dime. Well, being broke ain't no crime. Just tell the world you're feeling fine. Keep going. Continue on the pathway of life. Be steadfast, unmovable, always abounding in the work of the Lord. In good times and in bad times, Galatians chapter 6 tells us, he said, don't be weary in well-doing, doing the right things, for in due season you'll reap if you faint not. David had a choice to make. At a time of overwhelming discouragement, he could have said, forget it, I'm done, put a fork in me, it's over. But he prayed. And he pursued. He kept on going. He chased him down because he had the go-ahead from the Lord. I want you to notice the last thing. We must close, but I want you to see this is a beautiful principle. So he gets God's permission to go. Verse number 9. So David went He and 600 men that were with him and came to the brook Besor. And those that were left behind stayed. And David pursued, he and 400 men, for 200 abode behind, which were so faint they could not go over the brook Besor. That's a wonderful principle. I'd like to encourage you to go back and read 1 Samuel chapter 30 this afternoon. The principle there is, he said, let's go. God wants to go. So all 600 of them went there. They had to cross a brook or a little river or a creek. And 200 of them, one-third of his fighting men, said, you know what? I can't go. I can't even see straight. My eyes are blurry. I'm bloodshot. I'm spent. I've been crying for 2 days. I don't know what to do. I can't go. And he said, don't worry. You stay here. We'll be back. Can you go? Can you go? Can you go? And two-thirds of the people went with him, but one-third stayed back. Don't get mad when someone doesn't make the journey with you. None of us are clicking on all cylinders at the same time. That's why we're in a body. Usually you don't sprain both of your ankles. You sprain one at a time. And the other ankle takes over the other one. It helps it during that time. Most people don't break both of their arms simultaneously. Break one, the other one has to help and do more there. Listen, when somebody's struggling, don't get upset with them. Love them. Be patient with them. The Bible says comfort the feeble-minded. Support the weak. Be patient with all men. David could have said here, you know, listen, if you're such a, you're so weak you can't go, forget you. He said, you guys stay here. Can you go? Can you go? Can you go? And they took off and went with him. They went on that journey with him, and God gave him a great blessing. But notice the next thing that happened. Quickly, if you would please, in verse number 11. So some stayed, then they went. And notice what happened to verse 11. And they found an Egyptian in the field and brought him to David and gave him bread. And he did eat, and they made him to drink water. And they gave him a piece of cake of figs and two clusters of raisin. And when he had eaten, his spirit came again to him, for he had eaten no bread nor drunk any water 3 days and three nights. And David said to him, to whom belongest thou, and whence art thou? And he said, I am a young man of Egypt. I'm a servant to the Amalekites, and my master left me because I got sick, and 3 days ago, and he said, I just can't take you. You're going to have to stay and die here in the field. Verse number 14, and we made an invasion upon the south of the Cherethites and upon the coast that belongeth to Judah and upon the south of Caleb, and we burned the Ziklag with fire. And David said unto him, canst thou bring me down to this company? And he said, swear unto me by God that thou wilt neither kill me nor deliver me into the hands of my master, and I will bring thee down to this company. Because of time, I'll not read the rest of the chapter. It's a great chapter. But they come, and they found this little Egyptian boy, this little Egyptian slave boy. He was laying in the field sick, without any nourishment for 3 days. He hadn't anything. He got sick 3 days ago. His boss said, listen, or his owner said, we can't take him. Leave him. Let him die. Let's go. And they took the group of people that they had gotten from Ziklag. They took all the loot and all the spoil, and they take off, and they leave this little dead, half-dead Egyptian boy there in the field. Those 400 men that left the brook Besor come over, and somebody finds him. He's still breathing, but he's sick. He's weak. And they take him his own provision, and they give him something to eat. And they give him some water that no doubt was very valuable, and they gave him something to drink. And when he did, he got revived again. And they said, David comes to him and said, buddy, what's your situation? He goes, well, I got sick 3 days ago. I'm from Egypt. I'm a slave boy to the Amalekites. We've been making a southern invasion, and we just now burned Ziklag with fire, and they take all the kids, and we're going. Hang on a second. What do you want to know? He said, well, if you'll tell me where you're going and what the plan is. He said, we'd like to know about that. He said, if you'll promise you won't kill me or turn me back over to my master, I'll tell you. And he told them, he said, we're going to go this way. And now that little boy leads them to the plan that he had already seen in his master's thing. And they come over the hill, and they see them all drinking and dancing and having a good old time. And they see probably all their wives and kids huddled in masses and see the drunken soldiers getting ready to party because of all the things they had gotten. And God gives them a victory. So what do you do when you're discouraged? Let me give it to you quickly. Number one, pray. Number two, pursue. Number three, find a little Egyptian boy that needs some help. Go find somebody who needs some help. Quit sitting in your house and crying and sucking your thumb and looking at your problems and go to a nursing home. Get on a bus route. Go find a Sunday school class. Do something for Jesus Christ. Find someone to help. That little person can help you. One of the greatest things we do and the saddest things we do when we're discouraged, we just stop helping everybody. We quit things we need to stay at. Go find a little Egyptian boy someplace. Go find a project. Go find someone you can help. Go find a single mom trying to raise some kids and do something for them. Go find a baseball team to coach. Go find a bus route to work on. Don't get into this apathetic stage of just sitting around and wondering why no one cares about you. Take off your bib and put on your apron and find something to do for somebody. Quit saying, no one cares about me. No one's doing stuff for me. And get out there and find somebody that needs some help. Go to a jail and preach in a prison. Go find someone that's just helpless and you think they can't help you. You might be amazed how much they'll help you. They'll help you emotionally, they'll help you spiritually, and sometimes they'll even help you financially. I have seen it happen, and our time is up, and I can't continue. But I'd like just to remember a few things. Number one, pray, pursue, and go find someone you can help. Go find someone you can love on, someone you can help on. Get your thumb out of your mouth and say, you know what, I'm finding somebody I can help. Quit sitting around in a pile of mess and saying, oh, just no one cares about me. You can do that if you want, but I think if David would have done that, he'd still been sitting outside of Ziklag, probably with a pile of stones on his little head. But he got up and did something. He prayed, he pursued, and he found in his pursuit, in his journey, he found someone he could help. I think we do that. Then may I just remind you, is there a brother or sister that maybe just not click on all cylinders? Maybe they're just not making this journey right now. They can't go with you on this battle. Don't forget about them. Love them. Encourage them. You write them notes. You not be someone to criticize them, but you help them. There were some guys, when they came back of the battle, they criticized those 200 that were too late. They didn't want to share their spoil with them. And David said, you men of Belial, you wicked, vile people, who do you think you are? You think we got the victory by ourselves? No, we'll share with everybody alike. The people who are doing well, the people that are struggling, all of us are in this thing together. May God help us with that principle as well. Let's pray together, can we?